to be with us today. That books and ideas may yet have some meaning in our life. Once lamented, history conscious, from mouth to mouth, but are rarely put on paper. Thank you.
It was more than 20 years ago that I first began to think of writing an autobiography. I plead guilty for that. After all, I had been actively involved in one of the most turbulent periods of Indian history, the freedom struggle, its achievement, and what came after. My generation was fortunate in being involved in all these three phases. I have been fairly inside the Indian political process for more than 5 decades. We had been gradually but inevitably drawn into it as high school students, and that time never returns. Just as Krishna, once he left Vrindavan after his most enjoyable years of childhood, never again returned to Vrindavan all his life. In my case, it was not such a total break, but a very different phenomenon which combined thought and action to the extent possible. Having been accustomed to some kind of self-expression since childhood, I had been putting my thoughts on paper. For several years, writing and tearing up the papers went on side by side for some unaccountable feeling that I was doing something not quite proper, like a teenager driving the family car on the sly, unknown to his parents or to the driver. Sometimes I felt I was smoking secretly, and when an elderly person came suddenly, my first reflex was to hide the cigarette. Then I summoned courage not to hide the cigarette. In other words, not to tear up what I wrote. Still, everything that went on paper remained inchoate and disconnected. After some more time, I discovered that what had survived my tearing up was gradually turning into a theme that seemed to make sense, relevant to what the country was going through. I then began to put it together with some stitches here and there to make it a continuous narrative. Then something like a book emerged. I ventured to share it with a very few friends, somehow overcoming my shyness and hesitation. They were my friends, but I knew that as literary critics, they were quite unsparing and even aggressive. And when they did not tear up my piece, my confidence knew no bounds. I believed that the coming generations would like to know what they were themselves unable to see, for no fault of theirs, since they were born much later. The book thus began like an amalgam of elements of a potential autobiography and outside events which don't fit into an autobiography. Thus it has already lost its autobiographical character, and as it took further shape, it jumped over me, became a sketchy story of India, and left me just as a narrator and Anand as a part protagonist. In a parallel development, my party leaders wanted me to remain in the political field. Ours being a native state, the field was not yet overcrowded at that time. When the general election snakes and ladders series started in 1952, I began with a big python, but after that several ladders lifted me up and up. The writing continued in bits and pieces. I tried to make it a shadow, to follow at a distance, entrusted it to someone called Anand, and saved it from assuming the character of a diary. This needed some effort, which I put in willingly because I wanted it that way. The book looks at the country and its people through the eyes of Anand, a young idealistic boy from a small village who goes on to become the Chief Minister of the state. He traces his childhood and early life in a village and a small town, his involvement in the anti-monarchy movement, his gradual ascent up the political ladder in independent India, and his life as a member of the Legislative Assembly. Anand begins his career with idealism and naive optimism in the belief that he was serving the people and doing nothing else, but driven by the harsh realities of the system, begins to feel sometimes that he is being involved in doing everything else other than serving the people the way he wanted to. Which of these two scenarios was the real one? To identify the element of service in all that is raging around us is not easy, but that is the elusive element that still makes the system tick, no doubt feebler and feebler as we go along. However, Anand's courage and enthusiasm for work make him popular and even more devoted to work. This is a mysterious magic here. The country just gets you, whether you like it or not. That is the compulsion of public life. As I followed Anand on his journey through life, I found him poaching more and more on my own experience, and indeed trying to overlay his individuality on mine. Being warned in time, I managed to keep him at a safe variance, albeit necessarily an intimate one, so he is not identical with me, whatever Khushwant Singh ji might say. Because it is the writer who knows what he has written. People don't know who I am. People don't know what the difference between him and me is. I know all these things, so my word has to be taken. I do not intend to elaborate on the content of the book beyond a few words. We are fully aware, both from inside and outside, of what is happening in the system of governance we have chosen. Yet, this is the one system we have. And if it fails to deliver eventually, we have nothing to substitute it with. It is my belief that between independence and now, the system survived valiantly, but is being constantly subjected to spells of internal corrosion. This manifests in so many forms that it is no longer possible to deny it or explain it away. I have taken up just one such area to depict the corrosion, namely land reforms, which was vital and relevant not so long ago, and I think to a lesser extent even today. This was a topic which started with the first five-year plan, when perhaps Mr. Venkatraman was in the planning commission, and it's going on continuously, plan after plan after plan. And what has actually happened to the legislation in regard to this has been brought out in the book. There is first the idea, and then come the maxim, the slogan, the declaration, the formulation of the program, the approval, the legislation, followed of course by the internal corrosion in implementation I spoke of just now. Bringing in change involving any leveling down by peaceful and constitutional means entails, and I hope I have done what I wanted to. I have also tried to bring out the criticality of the efficacy of legislation as the main weapon for social change and progress. Now that the book is out, I leave it to you, my readers, to judge it the way you choose. So far as I am concerned, I have derived from it the pain of prolonged labor and the satisfaction of a difficult delivery. I am happy that Atalji, the poet, is here amongst us to release the book when he is Atalji, the Prime Minister. Considering the fact that I only mention the ruling party and not name any political party in the book, I wonder if this book has been awaiting Atalji's assumption of office. I accord him a most hearty welcome. I am, of course, grateful to my publishers, the Penguins, and Avik Sarkar and his colleagues for making the occasion a success. And most important, I am grateful to all of you, experts and connoisseurs of the press and other distinguished guests, for gracing the occasion, and welcome you very, very cordially. Thank you.
It gives me great pleasure to release Sri PV Narsimha Rao's book, The Insider, published by Viking. It is a privileged moment for me. Till now, we have been familiar with Sri Narsimha Rao, the politician. He once famously said that politics is the art of the possible, and went on to prove it during his 5-year tenure as Prime Minister. As a matter of fact, he proved that politics can also be the art of the impossible. After all, he is the only Prime Minister, apart from Pandit Nehru, Indira Gandhi and Rajiv Gandhi, who has completed the full term of 5 years in office. Now we have with us Sri Narsimha Rao, the writer. I would first of all like to congratulate Sri Narsimha Rao for his literary achievement. If reading a book of 767 pages itself is a challenging thought, one can only imagine what an enormous test of patience and determination it must have been for Sri Rao to write this book. But he has passed the test with great success. Therefore, let us give him a big hand. Today, as I release Sri Narsimha Rao's book, I am reminded of an interesting role reversal. And a reference has been made to that incident by previous speakers. In 1995, it was Sri Rao who released my book, Meri 51 Kahaniyan, Kavitaen, I'm sorry. This is what fiction has done to me. Meri 51 Kahaniyan. A collection of 51 poems in Hindi. We may belong to different political parties, but I have always received much affection and friendship from him, and this is what I shall always cherish. To be honest, I have only glanced through the book, primarily because it has been a hectic fortnight. It is autobiographical fiction based on India's modern political history, but the little I have read of the book convinces me that it is an interesting account of the life and times of many people who played an important role in the shaping of post-independence politics, especially Congress politics.